I brought up the border wall. We talked about that, but then this gets into this debate issue. Give us the latest update today. What is the debate on debate right now? There's supposed to be one on September 10th on ABC
yeah.
with David Muir and Lindsay Davis, who does not like Donald Trump.
Yeah, I think that's safe to say. Well, I mean, how we got to this point, of course, is that previously Donald Trump had agreed to this exact debate, September 10th, with all the rules and everything intact, agreed to it with Joe Biden. Obviously, Joe Biden is out of the race. So then in comes Kamala Harris, and she demands that Donald Trump stick to what he already agreed to when Joe Biden was the candidate, even though they had already pulled the old switcheroo. That, I mean, just to be frank about it, the previous existing agreement with ABC didn't exist anymore because that was an agreement that was made with Joe Biden. But Donald Trump said, all right, you know what? Fine, we'll do it. We'll do September 10th, just like it was all lined up, even though you guys did the old switcheroo and you got a new candidate in there. Fine, we'll do it. Then she comes along.
You call it a switcheroo or a pusheroo?
Oh, well, a pusheroo. Yeah, right. I mean, that's what it was. They unceremoniously dumped him. Remember old Joe Biden? He used to be president. Remember that guy? So they come in and they say, oh no, now we want to change the rules. Now we want to change about the muted mic or whatever, you know, because Biden had insisted on a muted mic. Now Kamala Harris says, we don't want the mics muted and whatever this. So now they're changing the rules when previously asserting that Donald Trump had to agree to the old rules with the old candidate. Otherwise he was a coward. So he did that. Now they're saying, nah, that's not good enough. So what? I don't know. You saw what the president said yesterday. I mean, that's outrageous. Maybe mics are good. Maybe muted mics are bad. I don't know where that's where we're at. We'll see what he says. And, you know, he's got his criticisms. It's not the rule that everyone thought we'd agreed to until the Biden campaign complained yet again. So we'll see where it all ends up. What I do know is when Kamala Harris is doing debate prep, she's being coached by a woman named Karen Dunn. Yeah. Who's doing debate prep for her, telling her what to say in debate, so giving her political advice on how to say certain things and what to say, what not to say, and all that stuff. You know what Karen Dunn's day job is? She's a lawyer, a high-powered lawyer in Washington. The Biden-Harris Department of Justice is suing Google, the massive tech giant Google. Karen Dunn is their lead defense attorney in that lawsuit. She is listed on court filings, and it says right next to her name, lead attorney. Defending the lawsuit from the Department of Justice, the case is the United States versus Google. So it's the executive branch suing Google. Who's in the executive branch? Kamala Harris. She's the vice president. She's being coached by the defendant's lawyer. It's an insane conflict of interest. Insane. Kamala Harris will never stand up to big tech. She's being told what to say by Google's lawyer. It's insane. Insane.
So there's two aspects that I think are fascinating. Because again, the big tech piece of this, to your point, which is broader, right? So the debate coach is from Google, who the DOJ is suing, right? To your point, there's that, the big tech thing. And then by the way, her other best friend is the executive at Disney that oversees ABC News.
Right.
I mean, this, you can't make this crap up. No. cannot believe this is what worries me, Tim, about the debate, just to be honest with you. And for everyone who knows this, I've watched Donald Trump. I've been around him. I don't care if that guy was in a well, wrapped up, blindfolded for 3 months, gets popped out. He'll still run circles around someone at a debate. Okay. Just so we're clear, he doesn't fear anyone. But the Google thing, the ABC thing, the moderator, Lindsay Davis, like they get it. The marching orders are clear. We cannot let this man become president again. I worry about how high the deck is stacked against him in the debate. I mean, you bring up the Google connection, the ABC News connection, the moderator issue. Like, are you concerned about the trap that's being set right now for Donald Trump?
Well, you know, I'm not sure that there's a place anywhere in the mainstream media where Harris would agree to come that wouldn't be loaded with traps like that. You know, people are rightly concerned about the names of the moderators and the record of the moderators and where the moderators have stood and how they've behaved in the past, including the very recent past. I understand that. And those are very real concerns, but you know, you do want to actually be able to face off. And we hope that there will be a time where that will happen. I'm not sure there are, you know, she's never going to, Harris, you go from some certain things that you already know. Harris is never going to agree to come to a Fox debate because the media is never going to hold her to it. And I know you try to carve out the best path and have the best moderators, and you just do the job that you can. Right. You do what you can. So now they're trying to change the rules again on this ABC thing. I don't know where that's going to land. I don't know what President Trump's ultimate decision is going to be. And I do want to say one more thing about this Google lawyer. I've seen some people on Twitter say, oh, whatever. Google has like 10,000 lawyers. And that's true. But only one of them is the lead defense attorney. Right. This isn't some random Google lawyer from the forest of lawyers. She is the lead defense attorney in the case where she is being sued by the executive branch. And that's Kamala Harris. This isn't a rando lawyer picked out of the crowd. This is the lawyer. She's of record on the case.
I am worried for you guys. And I don't say that because Donald Trump can't handle anything. I know he can. I've seen. Sure. But I've just context is important. You had Russia collusion, the laptop, the suppression, the lawsuits to try to get them off the ballot, the lawsuits civilly and criminally. Like they get it. This is like, I think the bat signal has gone up to the people at ABC. Hey guys, it's now up to you to stop this guy. Like we've tried everything. It's up to you. And I get very worried about this because they are literally like, they've thrown the kitchen sink. Now they're like, investing in sync hardware, and they're going out there and they're like, we got it. We got to stop this guy. I want to just pivot though, one big tech to another. Mark Zuckerberg puts out this letter yesterday to a House committee and basically says, hey, I got three things I need to go to confession for. One, heads up. The Biden-Harris administration pressured us to censor Americans when it came to discussions around COVID, and we kind of caved. So that's number one. Number two, we censored all these Americans for a variety of things. And the other thing we censored was Hunter Biden's laptop story. So there you go. But here's the end of my letter to you guys in Congress. I did all these Zuckbuck things. I funded a lot of stuff. I thought it would help both sides equally. Clearly it didn't. A lot of people think, so I'll stay out of future elections. But this was sort of like a massive confession from Zuckerberg. What do you make of the letter that he sent and how that might impact the election?
Well, I don't know what impact it will have on the election. It's hard to say. If I think those Zuckerbucks did have an outsized impact on the 2020 election because he was spreading around get out the vote money in Democrat strongholds, juicing Democrat turnout while doing nothing to impact Republican turnout. So that absolutely did have an impact. And so if he's not doing that, that has an impact too, because the positive for the Democrats won't be occurring in theory, at least you would think. But I'll tell you why I think this is important, because every time we have on the right, if we've been critical of social media, whether it was Twitter at the time during the laptop in 2020, or whether it's been Facebook all the way through, whatever it is, people on the left always say, that's not a First Amendment violation because private companies can do whatever they want. Only the government can violate the First Amendment. The First Amendment only protects people from government interference into their right to free speech, right? Well, what happens when it's the White House telling Facebook and others what to do? That's why this letter is important. Yeah, it's a confession of what Mark Zuckerberg said Facebook did, but the key part is the many instances where he says, we did this because the White House told us to, the White House pressured us to. That is a direct violation of the First Amendment. The White House, the Biden White House, the Biden-Harris White House has been consistently engaged in violations of the First Amendment, unconstitutional behavior from the Biden-Harris White House. To me, that's what the Zuckerberg letter means.
Yeah, I was glad to hear. Do you think that I felt like the reason, well, let me ask you this. Why do you think he confessed to all this? Like, because he just wanted to get it off his conscience, or was he trying to get ahead of something?
I think that the timing of this, I mean, here we are in the 70s, number of days left before the election. He must be trying to get ahead of something. I mean, the social media, Mark Zuckerberg, he's very visible in his leadership of Meta and Facebook. People know who he is. He's an easy target. Maybe he doesn't want to be a target anymore. Maybe he is trying to get ahead of something. Regardless of what his motives were, the letter that he wrote and admitting all the things that he now admits that Facebook did that was unfair. To me, the key point, once again, is that those things that he did, while it would have been okay for a private company, I wouldn't think it would be agreeable for them to do it, but they'd be within their rights to conduct their business how they want. But when they're doing it on behalf and at the orders under threat from the federal government, that is a violation of the First Amendment. And that is what I think Americans should really be riled up about.
Yeah, I have a feeling that he knows Congress or the DOJ or something's happening. And he is trying to basically say, okay, trust me, I won't do it again. Or he's getting ahead of Donald Trump.
Yeah, I think maybe he might be.
I worry that Trump's going to get back in office, and I worry that you guys are going to. So trust me, Mr. Trump, I'm going to stay out of this. I think that's his angle. You are known as a media strategist and communicator and operative, right? There's a poll that came out that showed if you're a Democrat, you trust the mainstream media, 73%. Independents trust the mainstream media, 36%, and Republicans only 10%. That being said, I like the new Donald Trump strategy of sitting for longer form interviews with non-traditional. Theo Vaughn was a great one. The Elon Musk one, Nelk Boys. Really interesting to me. What is the theory behind that? And are you going to do more of it?
I think you probably will see more of that. And I think it's a recognition that this is not the same media that it used to be. I just saw a thing online the other day that Megyn Kelly, her YouTube channel, outpaces the networks. If you even combine the networks, she gets more viewers than the traditional broadcast networks can dream of getting right now. The way people think about the old media is long gone. Right. Long gone are the days where you talk about, oh, who should we give it to? ABC, NBC, or CBS? No. Now you're talking about outside the box, Joe Rogan, Megyn Kelly, like you just said, Theo Vaughn, Sean Spicer.
That's
you
okay.
know, the list of the Mount Rushmore of alternative media, you know, Sean. But that's what I'm saying. And that's where your voters are. You want to reach young people, 18 to 35s or whatever. Theo Vaughn is where you go. You don't sit right. down with, you know, who are you going to do? You know, Kristen Welker, Chuck Todd, all these folks, they don't reach the demographics, everything. There are so many choices out there on the internet and alternative media with, you know, whatever else you can find, go talk to those folks. That's where your audience is going to be. You know, you spend, of course, with a guy like Joe Rogan, you got to commit to sitting there for 3 hours.
And yeah, that, but it's a big impact.
You know, but it's a huge impact and tens of millions of listeners, way, way more than you would get on any of these traditional TV outlets. And so, yeah, I think you'll see a lot more of that. And I think it's much more effective.
So speaking of kind of reaching new audiences, this RFK endorsement Friday and then Tulsi Gabbard yesterday, kind of big deals. What do you guys want to do with them? How do you want to deploy them in the most effective way to have the greatest impact?
Well, you know, without getting ahead of everything and what the plans
are. No, get ahead of it. Get ahead.
For announcing it. Yeah. I mean, I think you will see these people. They are absolutely. RFK Jr. has talked about, you know, there are other Democrats coming, and Tulsi Gabbard was the first one that came along after he said that. I think in case of the RFK thing, this is a huge, you can tell that it's going to be a big deal because the Harris campaign and the media are desperate to try to tell everyone that it doesn't matter at all.
Right.
And that's how you know that it actually is going to have some impact. We have polling. Then Tony Fabrizio released a memo just the other day. If you look at the seven battleground states that everybody really focuses on, and those are Pennsylvania, Michigan, Wisconsin, Nevada, Arizona, Georgia, and North Carolina. If you go around geographically in a circle like that, that's where they all are. RFK is polling somewhere between 3% and 5% in each of one of those states currently, with Harris at the top of the ticket. He was getting more when there was Biden, but now that it's Harris, his number went down a little bit, and it averages around 4 points. It stands to reason that most of the people who are with RFK who would go to Harris, they've already gone to Harris. So the lion's share, and our polling shows this, most of the remaining RFK vote goes to Trump now that he has dropped out and will be off the ballot in these battleground states. That means as much as a point in the final totals for Biden, for Trump in all of these states. And in Pennsylvania, if you're talking about a half point, three quarters of a point, or a full point, that could, and it's already razor thin there, that could well spell the difference. This is a big deal. It's very important.
Well, if you enjoyed this content, make sure to like this video, subscribe, and click the notification bell to get more.